Now, what is a power swing? It is a variation in three-phase power flow which occurs when generator rotor angles are advancing or retarding relative to each other in response to changes in load magnitude and direction, line switching, loss of generation, excess load, fault happening, fault clearing, and other similar system disturbances. What happens is that if you consider this as a relaying location, and there is a system behind the relaying location and a system in front of the relaying location, due to disturbances in the grid, it might be possible that the relay sees a variation, a cyclic variation in voltage and current caused due to reshuffling or rearrangement of rotor angles of the equivalent systems. Physically, it is easy to understand with two generators. In a network, it is difficult to understand, difficult to comprehend like that. But you can always think of networks being a equivalent generator. So here, when you discuss power swing, you have to think the network in terms of equivalent generator. You know, it will be easier for you to understand. The pole slip. What is a pole slip? What is the difference between a, let me talk stable and unstable first, then pole slip. What is the difference between stable power swing and unstable power swing? Stable power swing is such that the generators do not slip poles and the system reaches a new state of equilibrium that is an acceptable operating condition apart from the previous one. So operating condition was there. Suppose there was a power flow from this to this. Now with something happening, some big generator going out over here, the power flow may be from R to S. So that is a power swing basically. Okay. But if it settles down into a new operating condition, then we have a stable power swing. If it does not settle down at a new operating condition and it continues to swing, then the generators are experiencing pole slipping and some corrective actions must be taken. That is known as an unstable power swing. Pole slip is a typical term used in generators where the generator or a group of generator, the terminal voltage angles go past 180 degrees. The terminal voltage angles of generator S and generator R are go past 180 degree apart with respect to the rest of the connected power system. So that is the definition of pole slip. Now in a diagram in RX plane, stable swings are those which will come from here and return back to the position. It will not cross the resistance negative axis. Or the opposite might also be true. The original load point might be in the left part or the negative R axis. Means the load, means if we plot the, suppose I is flowing from here to here, S to R. If we plot the RX, if we plot the impedance seen by S end relay, it will be in probably past plus R zone. If you plot the impedance of minus the R end relay, the impedance will be in the minus R zone. So either it is for an unstable swing, either it is crossing from left right to left or left to right also, that is a swing. That is also the same thing, just a different view of things. Now there's one thing I just, this is the picture of a generated power swing using a test kit. What happens is that I put this picture before everything else because to make you understand one very important thing. It's what is the slip frequency? The slip frequency is the cyclic variation envelope frequency of this variation. Means this is the first swing, the current increases, IA increases, and the voltage decreases. So the slip frequency is not this 50 hertz. This is your 50 hertz. Slip frequency is the time from this by this. We can see from here it is 200 milliseconds. As the slip frequency will be 1 second divided by 200 milliseconds equal to 5 hertz. This time difference, the time difference of the envelope, the maximum and minima of the envelope, that is your slip frequency. That is what is important in power swing, not the absolute power system frequency. This is what is going to decide all the polygon sizes and shapes and all these things. So this diagram is important. Again, This is the sleep frequency or the power swing frequency or the pulse sleep frequency, as you call it, that is not 50 hertz or the power system frequency. It is this particular timing we are talking about. What is frequency? Basically, it's the number of repetitions per second. So it's a timing which matters for one repetition. That will decide the number of repetitions per second. This timing is what we are talk. We'll talk about this thing for the entire part now. What is the necessity to detect power swing? What happens is that during a power swing, the impedance fluctuates, and the impedance might come between our zone 3 or zone 2 or even zone 1, and it might be due to a stable power swing also. Now, we don't want our power system to trip due to relay misoperations for stable power swings. We might have a situation which is unstable power swing. There we might allow tripping, but that is only for select points in the network, which are interconnection points where the grid instability can happen. Those are different, separate things. But in general, during power swings, we do not want our network to trip unnecessarily. So we block our distance protection relay during swings in the network. So what might operate means misoperation can occur in distance zone. It can also occur in overcurrent. Like this picture was showing, the current is increasing very high. If you have instantaneous protection installed, instantaneous overcurrent protection installed somewhere in the network, it might be possible that it might trip in a power swing. Or you have some under voltage protection involved somewhere, it might be possible that under voltage gets activated during a power swing. So zone 3, overcurrent, high set, etc. These are the most vulnerable protection which might get tripped due to a power swing, which we don't want. And it is also important to detect power swing when we want to separate networks during unstable power swing. That is known as a power swing tripping, not blocking. But in the majority of this section, we'll talk about power swing blocking, not tripping. What is the action taken during power swing? We block distance zones. Generally, in typically Indian scenario, zone 1 is not blocked and only the higher zone is blocked. But it might be argued that if we have a power swing tripping function, then why not block zone 1? Because zone 1 is also vulnerable for power swing. Typically for longer lines, zone 1 is also vulnerable. But as of now, we generally do not block zone 1 because zone 1 generally goes for, it generally is the lowest impedance zone. So that is not larger. So we are expecting the power swing impedance not to enter zone 1 anytime, any odd time it will not enter. Zone 3 is the most affected. That is why zone 3, zone 2 are higher zones are deactivated by power swing. What are the properties? It's a three-phase balance phenomenon. There is a cyclic variation of voltage and current in inverse proportionality, thereby creating cyclic variations in Z, in impedance. The equation, I have written it directly over here. I have the derivation of this equation in the last part, which I'll not get time to discuss most probably. But you can just go through it. That is taken from the books. Any book on power swing and pulse sleep will give you these derivations very easily. Mason is one book, very lucid to read. The impedance seen by the relay location is this one actually. The ZT is the total impedance of the system, means the source impedance of the remote and the local ends, and ZL is the line impedance. This entire thing, this entire AB is your ZT. So this ZT by 2 and multiplied by 1 minus J cot theta by 2 minus your ZS rather. In this particular diagram, ZS is the ZA. So that is the impedance seen by the relay during any condition, or rather during any point theta. The connection between the load point or any point in the z plane which is subtending, or this zt subtends an angle of theta at a particular load point, the impedance seen by the relay during that condition. This equation is not valid only for power swing or things like that. This is a valid equation for any point in the any operation point. Okay, only the condition, there is a relationship between your total impedance, the remote end, the line, the local end, and the subtending and the angle that that total impedance subtends on your load point. This impedance is based on this equation is based on this, but this equation will be used to understand power swing very often. It has certain conditions, of course. The condition is that EA equal to EB. The voltages at these two terminals are assumed to be equal, and it's a lossless line, and all those things are there. So, from here, if you differentiate this equation, then the rate of change of impedance will come somewhere to here, ZT into omega. Omega is a d theta dt, the rate of change of this angle. Now, what is this rate of change? I'll come back, come in the next 2-3 slides, you'll understand it. It will come like this. So, basically, the change of impedance is related to the change of this angle. The impedance seen by this the relay impedance, the impedance seen from relay location to a load point is your Z1, and the change of this impedance is related to change of this angle. In a physical level, we'll understand in a diagram, phasor diagram. Through equations is difficult. Let's not go into the details. Now, what happens in a power swing is that the load point, this is a normal load point, the impedance comes inside the distance zone, and if it is an unstable swing, goes out of it. If it is a, say, stable swing, it comes inside and again returns back. That is the difference between unstable and stable swing. What is the detection criteria of impedance based? Now, why is impedance very chosen method, impedance seen by the relay a chosen method for power swing detection? There are other methods also, and which are not absolutely unpopular, which are quite popular. But in a line relay, as it is an impedance relay. So, in a line protection scheme, in order to understand power swing, why use any other method? Your best method is impedance, because as it is, the relay is already measuring the impedance seen by the relay. So, if we design a impedance-based power swing detection, that is the easiest to implement in a line relay. We don't need anything else. So that is why impedance-based power swing detection schemes have become very popular in impedance relays, in line relays. The detection is rate of change of impedance based. The principle is based on the fact that Z1, the positive sequence impedance, not zone 1, okay, positive sequence impedance, travels in the complex plane with a relatively slow pace, whereas during a fault, the positive sequence impedance switches from load point to the fault point almost instantaneously. Means during a fault, the operating point comes from here to here almost instantaneously. This is the line angle, say. So the fault point is on the line angle, or a resistive ridge somewhere over here. This is the load point. So the trajectory moves almost very fast. That is fault. If the trajectory moves slowly, relatively slowly to the fault, then that is a power swing. So various schemes. We'll talk about the last scheme. This is just I've given for legacy purposes, just to bring out the concept. There's a single blinder scheme. You have a single blinder. So what happens? The impedance falls, impedance goes inside this. a power swing is detected. The impedance goes outside this, power swing is, resets. So you have two blinders, left blinder, right blinder. It's a very old scheme, not even talked about now. I think some CEH relay or something like that used this scheme in English electric schemes. Something I've forgotten, WCD or CEH, something like that. So single blinder, only unstable power swing detected, because you are not detecting the power swing while it is in the stable region. You are detecting when it has almost become unstable. So the delta T has to cross left and right, delta T to cross left and right blinders exceed delta T minimum. So the timing of the crossing of these two points is your detection criteria. So the detection only takes place when the relay has crossed this, means when the swing is already unstable. So what, how does this relays operate? The timer, the timing between the crossing of the left blinder, sorry, the right blinder and the left blinder is monitored. If the timing is more than the set time, it is a swing. If the timing is less than the set time, it is a fault. That is how they used to understand. And the impedance was seen to be above this or below this. Now, this, over here, out of step clipping may be implementable, but out of step blocking, power swing blocking is not that much implementable because the zone will already be crossed. So this is not used nowadays very much. The double blinder scheme, this is used, but nowadays it is not, nowadays with the numerical relays, it is not needed. But the concept of the numerical relays has been born from this double blinder scheme. Over here, both are stable and unstable swing detectable. The delta T, the timer to cross this outer and inner boundary, has is, if it is more than the minimum timer, then a power swing is declared. If the impedance crosses these two above this time, then it's a swing. If the impedance crosses these two boundaries below this time, this is a fault. Okay, so an out of step implementable to way to trip into the zone or its way out of the zone. We can program out of step tripping while it comes in or it goes out. Of course, you will program out of step tripping on the second swing, not on the first swing. One more thing to say over here. Later on, you will we'll talk. Generally, this first swing is a little slower swing. The subsequent swings are faster. So your power swing detection has to be able to detect slow swing also and fast swing also. In this diagram, basically all the swings are of same duration. Normally in the real world, this will be of a bigger duration and these guys will be of a smaller duration. So this is a double blinder scheme. So you have two impedance blinders and the crossing is monitored and the time of crossing is monitored. You have now concentric characteristic. This is almost, this is the thing used in numerical relays. You have a mo or a quad, whatever, and you have this, you have an impedance band. Like those quadrilateral area problems we used to solve in when we were children. Like this band, carpet area, those problems. You have a band and the crossing of this band is monitored with respect to time. When the impedance is crossed earlier than the set time, then it is a fault. If it remains within this zone, beyond the set time or the fixed time, however, it depends on the relay, then it is a power swing. Dual quad is most popular as it can blend with modern quad distance zones, which has independently variable resistive reaches which can allow for greater flexibility. That is with respect to load encroachment and everything else can be incorporated into this or this characteristic. Both are almost same. This is a non-directional characteristic. This is a directional. Normally in a power swing, we will have non-directional characteristics. We won't have this sort of things. Because the power swing can occur from this end also, from this end also. The power can be import also, the power can be export also previously. Okay, so normally directional things are not used in power swing. It's a non-directional blinder creation over here. Okay, the ideal requirement is the inner blinder should be greater. The inner power swing boundary, the inner boundary should be greater than the maximum zone from which blocking is required. Because if the zone enters, then what use is the blocking? It will trip it as it is. So I have to detect the power swing before my maximum zone is entered. That is why the power swing inner boundary is kept above zone 3. And the power swing outer boundary is generally kept below the maximum resistive reach. That is to prevent the power swing operation caused by heavy loads. If you have a load encroachment characteristic cutting out the power swing zone also, you don't have a problem with it. Like in ABB relays, the load encroachment also encroaches or it protects the power swing boundaries also. So you don't have a problem. But otherwise, in general, in majority relays, that is not the case. In general, my outer boundary, this outer boundary should be below my resistive maximum resistive reach, and my inner boundary should be above my maximum zone reach, or majority times it's zone 3. And that is how it should be set. What are the challenges in long lines? In long lines, what happens is that the zone 3 is so big. The zone 3 is so big that there is not much provision to provide enough space for what happens in long lines with higher load flows. The zone 3 increases and the load impedance decreases. So we have very little boundary to create for detection of that power swing. We'll just go qualitatively on a setting description. There you'll get the idea better. So there's A and B two different conditions. This is the source impedance is lesser and the line impedance is more, so that it gives a long line and strong source. In A, the swing locus could enter zone 2 and zone 1 characteristic during a stable power swing for which the system could recover. Because the power swing boundary normally either will be, this is a MO, so there might be concentric circles. This blue one might be one circle and this violet one might be one circle. From this violet one might be one circle, or maybe outside zone 3, sorry, outside zone 3 it will be. So outside zone 3, there might be two circles over here. But what is happening is because the zone 3 is very high, so I won't be able to detect the power swing earlier than my zone 2 or zone 1 gets encroached. Means if I have a bigger, my inner boundary, I might not be able to detect the power swing before already it goes into the inner boundary. So that might cause unnecessary tripping. The very thing I am trying to protect is not getting protected because the impedance of the line and this everything is very high. The line impedance is primarily very high. So this can already go inside the line before being detected. Okay, for A, the power swing inner and outer is difficult to set. For A means the long line and strong source, and B is the opposite of it, the short line and weak source. Over here, it is easy to set. The power swing inner and outer Z is difficult to set, especially if the line is heavily loaded, because the necessary PSB settings are so large that the load impedance could establish incorrect blocking. means the load only comes within the power swing outer boundary. Then incorrect blocking, because the load is, it is always remaining. So it is always, so the distance protection will always be blocked under load conditions. That is what this paragraph means. For B, it is easy to, relatively easy to set, because we don't have that sort of problems. You can easily detect the swing much earlier. What are the challenges in providing, finalizing the PSB setting? It's a choosing of the delta Z, this band, the resistive or the resistive or the inductive, whatever. The power swing basically is a resistive sort of a phenomenon, because it's power, it's not fault. So it enters from along the R axis, the majority movements you will find. Of course, the X changes also a little bit, but it is the major, majorly it's the R axis phenomenon. So you will have to choose this zone. So this is the ideal situation. The load region is lying outside the power swing boundary, and the highest zone is lying inside the power swing boundary. This is the inner blinder, and this is the outer blinder. Inner blinder, right, inner outer right, inner outer left, like this. Majority relays define either as a band, it defines, RFI relay defines it as a band, delta X and delta R. ABB relay has a whole lot of settings. I'll just show the diagram, and I think it had around 15 or 14 lines that to be drawn in our double test kit. It's so complicated over there. Basically, it's a reinforcing of that zone. That is why the diagram is little like that. Okay. So, what are the things to be which causes problems to us? The choosing of this band, the choosing of the timer within which this band will be covered, because these are all things which require system studies. This is not going to, you cannot just like that think in which system, what is the swing frequency, how much band I'll have to keep to catch this amount of swing frequency. These things you need to know. So that is difficult. What is the expected slip frequency of the first and the subsequent swings? Generally, the first swing is the slowest, having around 2 hertz frequency, and thereafter it increases to 5 hertz. It will not be reduced, it will be increases to 5 hertz. It normally the second swing and are a little bit higher. So the design, the primary criteria of your power swing polygon designing is to catch the frequency of 2.5 hertz. That is the most difficult portion. We'll understand why, but in a qualitative level you can understand. The slower it is for a fixed amount of, if the relay, now there are two different kinds of relays. One is both are settable, like the ABB relay. Both the band is settable as well as the time of traversing is settable. But in majority relays of the world, the time of traversing is not settable. Like in RFI relay, the time of traversing is 5 milliseconds fixed. In some other relay, it is 45 milliseconds. Okay, so so to catch this first swing, that is the most problematic, because as the, if the swing is slower for a, for let's say 5 millisecond duration, if this delta t is same or fixed, then to catch a slower swing, the delta Z has to increase. The band has to be higher, because it is moving slowly from the load point to this point. It is moving slowly. So for a set time to catch a slower swing, the band has to be increased, which is somewhat difficult in many cases. Another thing is there, what is the source impedance to choose? Because you will need the amount of source impedance. You can choose zero and operate only on the line impedance, but that is not perfect. In many cases, the source impedance is not very clear what to take. Okay, this is power swing zone should ideally be inside load but outside zone. In long lines with heavy load flow, following these guidelines may be difficult. Now, this is the one mathematics I would like to give you, because if you understand this this line, the rest of the things you will figure out by yourself. You don't need to understand nothing. This is the relationship between the resistive reaches and these angles and time and slip frequency. I'm going a little bit slow over here. After this, I'll just wrap it up first. What is slip frequency? Number of times the pole slip repeats in 1 second. So if I have a slip frequency of 5 hertz, it means in 1 second, the vector slips poles or rotates by 360 degree 5 times. So it to traverse 360 degree, so in 1 second it traverses 5 times 360 degree. So to traverse 360 degree once, it will take 1/5 second unitary method. So to traverse 360 degree, it will take 1 by swing frequency seconds. So to traverse 1 degree, it will take unitary method 1 by fs divided by 360. So to traverse delta theta, what is delta theta? The difference between this angle, although delta in is I have given as half of this angle, the actual thing should be this angle minus this angle. This is the what the inner blinder we choose. That is subtending on your ZT, and this is the outer blinder we choose. That is subtending on your ZT. Or the ZT, the total impedance of the line as well as the sources, that is subtending a particular angle on the inner and outer blinder. And these two, the difference between these two angles, is what we are catching. Over here, this is how the impedance is flowing. This is not exactly, I mean, Z1 minus Z2 divided by delta T. It won't happen like that. It's not that easy. So this angle has to come, and that is why when you see the power swing setting calculations, you find it a little bit confusing because of the mathematics involved in this theta, in the angle subtended by the ZT or the total impedance on the outer and the resistive outer and the inner blinders, outer and the inner power swing zones. So in order to traverse 1 degree, it takes so much second. So in order to traverse delta theta degree, it takes delta theta into this amount of seconds. What is delta theta? So in order to traverse this amount of length, in order to the relationship between this timer involved over here, this is the timer through which the power swing impedance is traversing, this delta T over here. So this timer is related to this theta angles using this particular equation. Now delta T equal to delta theta divided by swing frequency into 360 degree. Delta theta is the double of this. So if I take the acute angle of this, not the obtuse, not the double, if I take the acute angle of this, which will help me a little bit in the mathematics, because this is symmetrical, we are considering it symmetrical. Exactly, it is not symmetrical, but for all practical purposes, it is almost symmetrical. So delta theta is your delta in minus delta out divided by this, because this 2 in 2 gets cancelled with this 360 degree. So delta theta degree is the inner blinder minus outer blinder angle, both being subtended on ZT. Both being subtended by ZT on the resistive axis, let us say. So tan theta in, theta in tan theta in will be equal to this one ZT by 2 divided by RN. This is the R inner resistive blinder, and this is the tan theta out, the relationship between r out and tan theta out. So theta in and theta out as a tan theta, z t by 2 this one, and you can understand it over here. So these are the basic mathematics involved. Now from here the settings will come. So what is the basic rule? First you decide what slip frequency to identify, then either in a relay the time interval is not settable, then you have to deal with the resistive blinders directly. You don't have any other option. But if the time as well as the blinder zone are settable, then deal with the resistive blinder first and then deal with the time interval. Means first you decide what frequency to catch, whether it is you want to catch 5 hertz frequency or 2 hertz frequency or 7 hertz frequency. Then if the time is fixed, then decide the band. If the time is not fixed, then decide the band first, because band will be because band will be cut off or restricted by your zone tree and the load. Timer is not that restricted. There is no restriction from the relay manufacturer point of view. So this is a general rule. So again, delta, this is a repetition of this one. Now, as theta in increases, this is reducing. As this angle is increased when the R inner blinder comes closer to the origin. And the other theta, the outer theta, will decrease when this goes above, when this goes towards the load, more towards the load. So in order to increase the delta theta, you will have to basically increase this blinder zone, this band. So for all practical purposes, delta theta is proportional to delta R. And this is the principle that Areva relay will directly use. Areva relay uses this principle directly to go from delta theta to delta R directly. It has a approximate relationship which works okay. Now this is the variable part. If the slip frequency decreases, then delta T increases. That is, a given delta Z is traversed in more time. Now the red part is important. Thus, to identify lower power sink frequencies, we need more delta T. If we have to identify lower frequency power swings, or the fast swing, very fast, I want to identify, very fast, FAST. Very fast, I want to understand the first swing. Then I need to identify lower power sink frequencies. There we need more delta T, or if delta T is fixed, then more delta Z. So the band has to be increased. Now if the band is unchangeable due to constraint of load impedance and higher resistive reach, then to catch the lower swing frequency, delta T has to be decreased. If delta T is unchangeable, then some lower swing frequency or slip frequency will be missed. There's no other option. Now this is a example calculation. I'm not going into the detail. I'll go into the detail from here. The source impedance local is 10, remote is 20, line is 120, total is 150. This is what is important for me, ZT. And from here, I get the R load minimum is 155. The values may, it is right, but I'm not worried about the values. The values I'll check and give the presentation. Now, normally, the outer boundary of the power swing is set at 80% of the R load minimum, or at least 90%, more than 90%, we should not go, because suddenly it goes down, then always power swing will remain picked up. 80% we choose as 124.46. Let's say the zone tree boundary, resistive boundary was 80 ohm. So inner resistive boundary, we choose as 120% of zone tree. Okay, this is 80% of load minimum. This is 120% of zone tree. So my band is 96 and 124. So it is around 28 ohms, 24 from here and 4 from here. 28 ohms band I have over here to detect power swings. let's say the maximum expected is for first swing is 2.5, the minimum maximum expected second or subsequent swing is 5. The angle theta subtended by inner z will be arc of tan ZT by 2 divided by R in. So 76 degree and 63 degree. So basically with this band, this is 76 degree and this is 63 degree. So delta T for detection of power swing would be some 15 millisecond. That will be delta in minus theta in minus theta out divided by this frequency, the first frequency, first swing frequency multiplied by 360. Okay, so this comes to around 15 millisecond. And for the subsequent swing, if there is a timer in the relay, if there is a different timer in the relay, which ABB relay has, to detect first swing and the second and subsequent swing, then you have to choose it differently. Generally, most of the relays have only one timer. So over there, this 15 millisecond should be the setting, if it is settable. And if this timer is not settable, then you will have to, this is say 5 millisecond, then to catch these swings, you will have to take upon this R in and R out. Then reverse tracking you have to do. From the theta, you'll have to go back to this delta R band and decide upon the R out and R. Okay, so this is how you set in the relay. This is example of all variation relay having everything variable. And if this timer is not variable, then the time has to be taken over here. The theta minus out will be decided, and from there the R in R out will be decided. The reverse phenomenon has to be followed. Block zone, which zone to block? You normally zone block zone 2 and above, and zone 1 is not blocked. Power swing unblock timer. This is a typical timer which is important in today's world, because If there's a power swing, we continue to get detected, then my distance zone will remain blocked forever. No, this is the timer which unblocks the distance zone when a power swing is continued to be seen. Because we always want to give priority to faults, not to swings. We don't want our relative swing to trip on stable swing, but our priority is fault. And that is very understandable from the next three lines, 11ABC. Whenever there is a fault current, whenever there is an asymmetry in the impedances, then you will have I1, I2, or I0, zero sequence for at fault, negative sequence for phase fault, positive sequence current for three-phase fault. So these are the unblocked levels. If there is, these are the unblocked levels, this is generally settable in the relay, or at least a zero sequence is settable, or a negative sequence is settable, which is applicable for all faults, then the power swing is unblocked immediately. Or maybe after a settable time, it is unblocked. If the I0 remains for a certain amount of time, the relay, the power swing will be unblocked. So this is how different relays operate on different principles. You cannot generalize it overall, but the basic methodology to set the impedance zone has been just covered over here. This is very sketchy, I know. This is an example of a power swing, modern day power swing detection band. See, this is the band. This is the delta FW, what we're talking. This is a band which we are setting in the relay. This is the delta R band which we are setting in the relay. Over here also, this is a G relay, the band which we are setting. Over here, it's more complicated. You have a middle blinder also. So you take power swing trip decisions based on middle blinder, and there you have a lot of, what to say, logics involved. Unblocking power swing during faults, this is more important as blocking, as during stable swing, any uncleared fault can create more and further havoc than swings. Different relay manufacturers use different techniques for unblocking by power swing detection. Different relay manufacturers use different various techniques for unblocking of distance zone blocked by power swing detection during faults. that appear while a power swing is in progress. While a power swing is in progress, the relay gets blocked. But up to this power swing unblock timer, after this, if the fault persists, then we go for a trip. And another thing is that there can be, again, this every relay manufacturer has created some different algorithms and different methodologies to for the duration on unblock. Some relays say that, okay, I'll keep the block till 2 seconds. I'll not unblock it before it. Some relays say on immediately there is a asymmetry, there is a fault current going on, the thing gets unblocked. Basically, power swing is a three-phase phenomenon. So asymmetry is a cause of concern over here. So the methodology of unblocking can use asymmetry also. Or there are some relays which have a threshold currents above which I will unblock. Whenever the fault current goes above which, then I'll unblock. So it depends how you do it. This is one non-conventional method. Those the thing discussed till now were all conventional. This is one non-conventional method used in this in Siemens relay typically. There are other methods. Another very popular method is swing center voltage method, which I have not dealt over here because none of the major relays in the market use it. So this is a continuous impedance calculation method. The principle is monitoring the progression of impedance in complex plane for all the three line-to-line AB, BC, CA impedances. Power swing declared when three simultaneous criteria for all the three phase loops have been fulfilled. Continuity, monotony, and smoothness. What is continuity? Successful delta R, delta X values is above a certain threshold. Means the trajectory is not motionless. The trajectory is moving. Monotony, the trajectory does not change direction. Successive delta delta x have the same sign. Smoothness, successive delta delta x must be below some threshold, distinguished from fault. Otherwise, it should move smoothly. If it is a fault, it moves abruptly. So that is, this is the parameter which is deciding from abrupt fault and this. And the final declaration would be on based on the current, continuous incremental current. The value of t is equal to 0 and t minus 2 cycles, that is more than 5% for three consecutive cycles, we declare a power swing. Now this is the thing that will distinguish it from fault. This is the thing, the declaration of power swing is based on this. Now the advantage of this method is no setting is required, no so much headache is required to calculate settings. Directly you can go. This is basically nothing, no set. This is the entire thing is non-settable. And it can handle slip frequencies up to 7 hertz. So this is a good thing to have. Not a bad idea. These are the diagrams involved in this. Basically the impedance calculation diagrams. It's self-explanatory. This is one method. I have not discussed so much. I'll not cover this one as time has already closed one. This is the relationship between equilibrium criteria and the power swing. If this area 2 is equal to area 1, we have the critical zone. If area 2 is more than area 1, it is unstable. If area 2 is less than area 1, it's a stable zone. So based on this only, this whole thing happens. This is just a repetition of college stuff. Is a derivation of general loss of synchronism characteristic taken from, I think I took it from Mason, yes. So then just go through it. I'll just discuss the main result. The current between these two is EA minus EB divided by these impedances. The impedance seen by the relay will be based on, this will be the final equation of the impedance seen by the relay is this. Which on condition, this is the final impedance, the general formula, final impedance seen by the relay. For the condition where EA equal to EB, which is means the voltage at the both ends are different, which is very same, which is very true for our interconnected system, then this special case comes into picture, which on which all those previous discussions were mostly based. So this is almost true for most power systems. So nothing wrong with it. This is the equation of a straight line. So when the voltages of these two ends are the same, the power loss of synchronism characteristic follows a straight line, which is a bisector of this line. This is what this whole thing means. When n is equal to 1, n is E1 by E2. When n is equal to 1, this loss of synchronism or loss of or the power swing will follow this straight line. If EB or EA is less than or equal to 1, for EA is greater than EB, or rather EB greater than EA, it is the circle curves upwards. If the source voltage is more than the load voltage, the circle curves downwards. That is as far as I remember. I don't exactly remember which one was the N, which is the numerator in N. I think it was EB by EA, right. If this voltage is more than this, the curvature is towards the upper side. If this voltage is more than this, the curvature is towards the lower side. I think it was EB by EA. It might be wrong. You can just check it. This is a diagram showing it's rather resembles a magnetic field. It is showing the family of circles ES by ER. Okay. When ES by ER, the source is more than the load side. This is S is the source side, R is the load side. So the answer is over here. If EA is more than EB, the circle curves upwards. Okay, it is seen from here. If ES, this is my ES, this is the remote end, this is the local end. ES is more than, the circle curves upwards. And for the typical case where ES equal to ER, it is a straight line. And this is the system impedance angle. So almost 80 degree they have taken. And this is certain waveforms taken from studies. Nothing very big about it. Just I wanted to show one thing. This is a study. See, this is what I wanted to show. The fast swing is slower. The subsequent swing are generally faster. The fast swing normally will be of a greater duration. That is applicable for, see, the fast pole slip is slow, then it happens very fast. This happens in real life also. The next one you see, it's a stable swing. What happens in a stable swing? It will go in, come out, go in, come out. So what happens, see, the inner blinder is the impedance goes into the inner blinder and also goes to the outer blinder. Starts with the outer blinder, then it goes into the inner blinder also, or after certain time, the swing is increasing. First of all, like this, it was happening. Then it goes inner, outer. This is what is shown over here. So this is a stable swing. Now what happens, the similar diagram in an unstable swing, and we'll end the presentation over here. In unstable swing, what happens? The outer and the inner are crossed simultaneously almost. So the swing is going from here to here, and here to here, and here to here, like this. So the outer, inner. Again, if you see on this side, inner goes out and outer. And this band also is crossed over here. So this is the power swing trajectory, crosses inner blinder as well as outer blinder, showing successive pole slips. In the previous one, power swing trajectory stops crossing inner blinder, but continues to encross outer blinder. Okay, so it is a stable swing. It came into the inner blinder, but with time it is decreasing. It is not further crossing the inner blinder with time. So it's a stable swing. This one is an unstable swing. It goes on continuing the outer blinder, and it goes on cutting the inner blinder and the outer blinder continuously. That is a unstable swing. These are certain references, good readings. You can just read. Model setting calculation can be referred to for help. A lot of things I have learned from this. This one is very good book, Automation Guide from Areva. Kimbark and Kundur are another very good books for learning power swing and pole slips. Other things are papers and like that. Some of the important papers from which I have learned a lot of things is these. So you can go through these papers and get a very clear idea of the things. Okay, thank you everyone for having a patient hearing. Today also I have shot my limit. So if anybody has any questions, or else you can write the questions directly to me if you want to understand something in a better fashion or more.